Ultimate Solvers program, which was basically a turbo fan jet engine. So it took me around 70 hours to finish it. And I'll just give a brief introduction and then we'll go to the part file and show you how it is done and everything else. So the basic objective of my project was to design and render the turbo fan engine using SolidWorks and SolidWorks Visualize. And while I was designing this thing, the technical properties and dimension tolerance were not elaborated. The main purpose was to apply whatever I have learned in my first two courses in SolidWorks program to independently build something a little bit complex, not a simple structure, a little bit complex that I could use both solid and surface modeling principles to test my knowledge or depth of skills, whatever I have in SolidWorks. So hopefully I could do it in a moderately good way, I believe. And basically you all may almost be knowing what a turbofan jet engine is. Turbofan engine is basically what you see, what carries the aeroplane, which is like the main part of the aeroplane, which holds it, which helps in propelling and everything. And basically the working is airflow only, the basic working principle. So when we think about airflow, we have whatever comes to our mind are a fan, nozzle, turbines, combustion chamber and everything. So basically I had constructed three basic parts for the jet engine, and those three parts are rotating section and a casing to protect the rotating section and to simulate the airflow. And finally, a nacelle. Nacelle is the main cowl or covering which we provide around the jet engine. So let's go to the first part. The first part is, this is the rendered image. So this is the assembled part model, as you can see. It consists of actually three parts. So this is the first part, which is the rotating section. So basically, as you can see, it consists of, it's a twin pole system actually. A twin pole means that there are basically two shafts which are concentric to each other and they rotate in opposite directions. That opposite direction is enabled to help simulate and help maintain the pressure inside the combustion chamber as well as the turbines. So the first spool basically consists of the main shaft with the fan. Let me see if I can annotate it. So this is the main fan, as you can see. And there is a low pressure compressor and a high pressure compressor, as well as high pressure turbine and low pressure turbine. So the first part of the first spool of the turbofan consists of the fan, then the low pressure compressor and the low pressure turbine attached to it. So this is the low pressure compressor and this is the low pressure turbine. The last four are low pressure turbine. So like I was saying that the first spool, in a twin spool system, there are actually two shafts. So the first shaft consists of what we can see here, that's the fan and the low pressure compressor and the low pressure turbine. Now, when you see the construction of a turbine, or first we'll talk about the compressor. So when you see the compressor here, you see that there is a variable blade length throughout the compressor. This is mainly, it actually uses a series of airfoil shaped spinning blades. which is used to speed up and compress the air, mainly as opposed to centrifugal flow. There is axial flow inside the chamber. So as the air moves through the compressor, each set of blades, its size is slightly smaller. The main idea is to add more energy. So when you design using SolidWorks, make sure, I'm sure that you will be modeling something different than this when it comes to independent project, but the basic idea should be, when you model, when we model something, there should be a logic which is built on science. So the basic idea was to enable the idea that when the air moves to the compressor, the more energy and compression should be acting on the air. And as you can see that the blades constructed here are in the shape of, there is a twist, as you can see, to the blade tip. It is to modulate the air properly. And instead of constructing blades with, a straight edge, jet engine manufacturing companies prefer to use this to simulate airflow. Basically, I borrowed this model, as you can see here. So from this is where I borrowed the concept. As you can see, it consists of innumerable pneumatic and hydraulic small tubings and all, which I have not modeled in my current project due to lack of time and other things. The second spool consists of the high pressure compressor, as you can see here. This is the high pressure compressor, and the first two turbines you see here are the high pressure turbines. How can we distinguish between a high pressure and a low pressure turbines or compressor is that a low pressure compressor will have, I'll take you to the next part. So this is the, we have to parallelly view both parts so that we can understand the basic mechanism. So this is what we call the casing. Both this and the shaft works together to simulate the airflow and to regulate the pressure of the air passing through the jet engine. So you will see a cut section view. So as you can see here, this is the chamber for the low pressure compressor, and this is the chamber for the high pressure compressor. So what we can see here is that the chamber is a little bit smaller, which directly correlates to the pressure of the air passing through it. The more smaller the chamber is, the more pressure the air will encounter when passing through it. And when it comes to the turbines, it's a series of airfoil shaped blades, very similar to the blades in the compressor. And as the high speed air flows through the turbine blades, they extract energy from the air, and in turn the engine shaft also turns. So this is the same shaft that the fan and the compressor are connected to. So by spinning the turbine, the fan and the compressor in front of the engine continue sucking more air, thereby it getting mixed with the fuel, and as a result, combustion takes place. So as you can see here, basically, when I zoom in, you can see that this is where the first spool ends with the, first spool is concentric with the second spool. That's the first shaft concentric with the second shaft. I have created a wedge here so that we can distinguish where the twin spool ends and where the second spool is situated and where the first spool is situated. Now we'll go to the second part, that is the casing. So the casing is the main supporting structure for the rotating section, and there are some elements, or there are some parts in the casing which greatly enhances the operation. Here, compression being the operation, which greatly enhances the compression operation to enable the proper functioning. So the basic part of the casing are stator vanes. Stator vanes are vanes or blades, permanent or stationary blades, which are placed between each compressor and turbine blades. So I'll show you how it functions. So basically, as you can see here, when we rotate, when the shaft is rotating, as you can see, it rotates. It's a moving part, whereas the casing is a stationary one. So as you can see here, the stator vanes are stationary. So it being stationary, when the air flows through the compressor, it acts as a barrier to the airflow, thereby increasing the air pressure, and which leads to a better combustion inside the combustion chamber. The basic principle of a jet engine, the basic working principle that we study in a jet engine, is that the air passes through the fans. It sucks in air, and the primary air passes through this and is and goes through the exit. The second strata of air passes through first the high pressure, low pressure compressor. Then it goes to the high pressure compressor, and from there, this is the combustion chamber. This is where the combustion or the fire occurs. Combustion happens. This golden color or yellow color elements which you see are fuel injectors. These get mixed. These fuel injectors inject the fuel, and the high pressure air gets mixed with the fuel, and their combustion happens in this combustion chamber. As you can see, combustion chamber, I have provided holes for the combustion chamber, so it enables proper mixing of air with the fuel. From the combustion chamber, the air passes through the turbines. The first set of turbines are high pressure turbines, which again increases the pressure of the air, and then the low pressure turbines. And eventually it goes out of what you can see, the support structure with the exhaust nozzle, this cone shaped. And thereby the jet engine enables the aircraft to move forward or propels it forward. And these, you can see a couple of tubings here. These are mainly just demonstrative in nature, just to show that this is the tubing that provides the fuel with the fuel injector. There are many more tubings when we design or when we see a jet engine, like the one I showed you. There are many more parts for a jet engine, which I have not created due to paucity of time. And the third part, as you can see, is the nacelle. So the nacelle is attached with the casing, and it again further gets connected with the wing of the airplane. It's a housing that holds the engine, and the other equipments on the aircraft. The primary design issue with any aircraft mounted nacelle is aerodynamics. Nacelles are usually attached to wings and are almost mounted underneath, that is the high pressure side of an aircraft wing. So the exhaust nozzle is also situated at the end. Now, when it comes to part modeling, the various commands which I have used modeling, as you can see. Basically, I used a combination of both surface modeling and solid modeling. When it comes to designing the blades, we have to make sure that there is a pattern of design which we apply on the blades or on the fans so that the airflow is better simulated when it passes through these chambers or fans. Airfoil shaped blades are preferred in jet engines. As you can see in the GE website, there is these fan blades. These are airfoil shaped fan blades. As you can see, is the front view of how a jet engine looks like in real life. So you can see that to enable better airflow, there is a twist to the blades, which I have applied here, as you can see. And same thing also applies to the blades of the compressor as well. You don't see a straight blade, you see a blade with a twist or with a design, slight design change, which enables the airflow to go through the combustion chamber as well as exit through the turbine. But when it comes to turbines, you can use straight vanes or straight blades without any design changes, because once the air reaches this part, it is already in a very high pressure. So once it gets compressed, the main idea is to eject out the air. So for ejecting out the air, there need not be an airfoil shaped blade, because the primary purpose is to burn off the air through the exit nozzle, and so that we can make room for more air as the plane moves forward. So basically, as you can see, like I said about the blades, I used surface modeling here, surface modeling, and basically if you see my tree, you can see that for surface, I have used surface modeling, I have used loft surface command, because we don't have a straight structure or a straight body here. It's a wavy type body. So from the base to the end, we have to connect two elements. We use loft surface command. And to make things easier for any project, the SolidWorks has many options to make our work easier. In this case, it's the main thing that I used is patterning. As you can see, I have only designed one blade for each of the parts. Rest of them, I have given a pattern, circular or linear or whatever. Same goes to this compressor. Like I mentioned before, you can see that the compressor has a decrease. I mean to say, there is a difference in size of the blades when the air moves forward. I have used split operation. Once I constructed the blades and once I gave them a linear pattern like this, I use split option to make a cut accordingly, and then I patterned each blade. The same principle or same commands or same idea was applied when it came to the high pressure compressor as well as the turbines. Now, when it comes to the casing, also you can see in my command tree that I have used a lot of patterning and a lot of thickening also. When you design moving parts or when you design components like this, basically you should made sure that I use surface modeling, then I use thickened surface to create a solid model. So in that case, we can decide what should be the thickness for the chamber or the sheet metal part or whatever, because once we can decide the thickness, it will be easy for us to design other parts. As you can see, every part in this model has relative dimensions. That is, there is no fixed dimension, it is all relative. Suppose the combustion chamber, or suppose the compressor blades are of this dimension, then the stator vanes of that should be relatively similar to the compressor blade or turbine blade. Keeping that in mind only, I have designed this. And you can see, when I click on here, you can see that circular pattern 39 is highlighted there. And you can see on the tree also that mostly I have used patterning, except for this model. This fuel injector was a bit tricky because I was not getting the correct alignment, because this has to be, because as you can see, this is not a straight or a flat surface, this is a curvy surface. So in order for the combustion for the fuel injector to be placed here, we have to use a command called move body, which we used, which you might have seen when constructing the headlines of the American chopper. To place it properly, we need to shift this axis a little bit and place it correctly. And then I again patterned it. And when it comes to combustion chamber also, I have given a little bit space for the air to get in. Otherwise, rather than being a closed combustion chamber, it is it's an open combustion chamber, which enables fuel injection in the same compartment as well. Basically, you have to make a closed nozzle, and when it comes to the exhaust nozzle, you have to make sure that the gap between the exhaust nozzle and the exhaust cone is very much less. And basically, if you see, this is a little bit tricky here. The upper part of the nozzle and the lower part of the nozzle are not at the same axis. If you take real-time nozzle pictures like Rolls-Royce or GE, you can see that for aerodynamic reasons, the upper part of the nozzle and the lower part of the nozzle are not on the same axis. So for that, I used loft surface creation, and after that I adjusted the axis. I'll show you. As you can see, the surface loft part. And then I knitted the surface so that it doesn't leave any holes. So this part was a little bit difficult for me to obtain, but eventually it worked. And so as you can see, these are the three main parts of the model which I built for my independent project. And these are the rendered images actually. This is the rendered image for the rotating shaft. And I used this rendered images which you see here is using Photo 360 only, so it's SolidWorks. For SolidWorks visualized, I used real-time environment, and I'll show you that. So these are the rendered images of the split view, as you can see. And this is the assembled view of the shaft and the casing. And this is the zoomed in view for you making visible the fuel injectors as well as the combustion chamber. And this is the rendered image of the nozzle. And this is the assembled view, as you can see. And this is the exploded view. This is the front and side view. And when it comes to SolidWorks Visualize, I searched for images where I could fit in the turbofan jet engine properly without much error, without much artificial appearance. So I downloaded this from the internet, this image, and actually there is a turbofan jet engine here, but using the proper controls in SOLIDWORKS Visualize, which I believe you all must be knowing, and a little bit of tweaking. I placed it, and by creating the correct environment and background, I could simulate this somewhat good picture of, and this is the second one. Again, this is the jet engine that I designed. I placed it accordingly. And like I said, the main purpose of this project was to like test and display the skills which I learned in the first two courses of this project course, that is the American Chopper and the yacht design. And almost all of the functions which I learned in those first two, I was able to successfully use and apply in this independent project. And there are many more parts when it comes to the jet engine, like I said, the pneumatic tubes and the electrical wiring, everything. There is also a lot of parts which require precise detailing, which were not designed due to passage of time. And basically it took me 70 hours to complete, including the time taken for rendering. The render depends upon your system requirements. So including the time taken for rendering, it took me 70 hours to complete. And when I first thought of doing this project, my support engineer Akash had told me it would be good if I do an independent project. And as I am very much interested in aerostructures and aero field and aircraft designing, I thought I will do something which has always interested me, that is jet engine design. And the first raw outline which I showed to my support engineer was a very bleak one. It is nothing compared to what I have done right now. That was something, the old one, which that was something I constructed within 2 hours or something. And that looks very bleak compared to what I have done now. So that really helped me that error, the previous model which was not worth, really compelled me to bring on much more advancements and much more changes to the model. And finally, I was able to submit a somewhat complex model for as the part of independent project. So, and yeah, and the references which I took were mainly from the websites of Rolls-Royce and General Electric. There are many models of their jet engines which we can find on their website. And there were also many YouTube videos which helped me to basically understand the function behind how a jet engine worked. And combining all this, I was able to put up a project without much error, I believe. So that's it. Thank you, guys.